So welcome, everyone. It is a delight to be here in the museum in person, as you can tell from the mask. And we do have an audience here. And if you're in the New York area and you have not yet been back to the museum, I do hope you'll come join us. The museum is open again 7 days a week, 364 days a year. My name is Cindy. I'm the director of MoMath. It's my pleasure to welcome both those of you who are here in person and those of you who are joining us remotely. I also want to give my thanks to the Simons Foundation, who is the sponsor of Math Encounters and has been allowing us to bring wonderful math presenters here for more than 10 years now. So our thanks go out to them. Let me please ask you to join me in welcoming Alex Kontorovich, our distinguished visiting professor, who will introduce tonight's program. Thank you.
Thank you, Cindy, and welcome everyone. Nice to see all of you here and those of you at home joining us, please welcome. You're in for a real treat. I've heard this once already, and so it's a really fantastic talk. Our distinguished visitor and speaker and guest is Professor William J. Cook. He's the university professor at the University of Waterloo in combinatorics and optimization. He received his bachelor's at Rutgers University, my employment currently, in mathematics in 1979, and then received a master's from Stanford in operations research, followed by a PhD from the University of Waterloo. He was formerly a professor of applied mathematics and statistics at Johns Hopkins. He was also the John Swanson Professor of Industrial Engineering at the University of Pittsburgh. He was the Chandler Family Chair Professor at Georgia Tech. He worked at the Program for Applied and Computational Mathematics at Princeton University. He was the Noah Harding Professor at Rice and the John von Neumann Professor at the University of Bonn in Germany, as well as a member of the technical staff at Bell Labs. He, among many, many accolades, he's a fellow of the American Mathematical Society and of the National Academy of Engineering. Among his many prizes and awards is an INFORMS Fellowship, a SIAM Fellowship, the Lancaster Prize of INFORMS, the Block Community Lecture, which he gave at SIAM in 2003, a Beale Orchard Hayes Prize, and he was also an invited speaker at the International Congress for Mathematicians, one of the highest honors mathematicians received in Berlin in 1998, among many, many other keynote lectures and named lectures that I won't go through so that we can actually hear what Bill has to tell us. He's also, just very briefly, the editor-in-chief and founding editor of the journal Mathematical Programming Computation, among many other editorial duties. He served on numerous prize committees and committees for international meetings. He has many books, lots of publications, obviously. You know, we're going to be talking about the traveling salesman problem. The title of the talk is Optimal Tours. I can't say that Bill has written the book on traveling salesmen because he's written two books on the traveling salesman problem. So with that, let me turn things over to Professor William Cook, who will tell us about Optimal Tours. Please welcome Professor Cook.
Yeah, thanks, Alex. It's great to be here at MoMath, and especially in person. For those of you on Zoom, there's actually an in-person audience, about the same number of people as watch the Olympics, but they're very vocal, so it'd be quite good. So I thank Alex, and I also thank the Simons Foundation for funding these Math Encounter series. So the traveling salesman problem, it's actually very simple. Right, we start here at MoMath, and we want to visit, say, six other of the famous museums in New York City. So what's the shortest way to walk from here to visit all those museums and return? I mean, that's simple. You just want a circular tour, short as possible, only 6 points. I mean, that's crazy simple. But the problem arises in many applications where there's numerous points. For example, during COVID, you've all ordered those Amazon Prime packages. Well, they're brought to your doorsteps by drivers that are following traveling salesman tours, typically doing 150 or more stops in a day. And getting short and safe tours for the drivers is important enough for Amazon that they organized a worldwide competition for people to try to get algorithms to help them get better and better tours. And with a lot of prizes, including $100,000 to the first place team. Okay, that's already 150 points, but traveling salesman problem goes beyond just moving people or an equipment. It also appears in other contexts. So like in genome sequencing, where there's many thousands of points, or machine scheduling, data analysis. Wherever you might possibly put points in a line, there might be a traveling salesman problem. So what I'm showing here are some of the companies that have obtained licenses to our Concord TSP code. So it's written together with Dave Applegate, Bob Bixby, and Basha Kvata. So we give the code for free to companies as long as they're willing to tell us what specific application they're going to use it for. That way, every week or so, I get this nice feedback from how people are actually using the problem. So it's quite nice. Some of them I really like particularly this one from Bayer. What I like about it, it's in genetics. What I like about it is the researcher clearly doesn't actually know what the traveling salesman problem is. She just knows she can't do her genetics research without the Concord solver. It shows you the power of abstraction in mathematics. So these direct applications are really nice, but that's only part of the interest in the problem. The traveling salesman problem also serves as a focal point for studying possible limits to computational power. So 2 years ago, at the World Economic Forum in Davos, so you've probably read about Davos, all these people coming in, they put out a report on the future of supercomputing. And their one-line summary mentions the traveling salesman problem. Or D-Wave, it's a quantum computer company. They sell these multi-million dollar machines. Their advertising features the traveling salesman problem. Or the Wolfram language, very powerful mathematics language. When Stephen Wolfram organized a press release to talk about it, the first problem he discusses is the traveling salesman problem. I have to point out that this code he's talking about is actually our code. We gave them permission to include Concord in Mathematica. All right, so in all these cases, the traveling salesman problem is serving as a point of discussion for possible limits to computing. So the center of complexity theory. Of course, in the popular press, this is a different story. It's already game over for the traveling salesman problem. Right? A few years ago, you could read in papers all across the country and all across Europe that 50 city problem, so the shortest route through 50 points, would take you more than the lifetime of the universe to solve. Or the Washington Post, a couple of years ago, said that 22 cities would take you 1,000 years. All right, so these doomsaying results arise from a simple counting argument, that there's just lots of tours to check. Right, so let's look at that. You have 5 points to visit. Well, how many ways are you doing that? Well, it's a circular tour, so it doesn't matter where we start. So I can just say I start at the top point. Once I do that, then there's 4 choices for the second point. Then for each of those, you get 3 choices for the third point. So now I have 12 possibilities, 4 times 3. And for each of these, you now still have 2 choices remaining. So you get 2 more choices. So now you have 4 times 3 times 2, it's 24. Now at that point, you only have 1 more point to visit, so that's it. So the total number of tours through 5 points is 24, which is 4 factorial, 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. So that's a small number. In fact, it's even smaller than that in many cases, because you notice there's patterns here. And each pattern appears twice, like the pentagon, because we're counting a tour going once in one direction and that same tour going in the other direction. So if you have an application where the direction of travel doesn't matter, so like a geometric problem, then you only have half that number. And this is the model that I'll be focusing on in the talk. All right, so 12 tours is not very much, but the number grows quickly. If I just go up to 6 points, I have 60 tours. If I go up to 22, have 25 billion billion. And that's where this notion of 1,000 years comes from in the Washington Post. So 1,000 years is about 30 billion seconds. So if you're doing processing 800 million tours per second, which is a lot, you would use up all 1,000 years. So there's nothing wrong with our counting argument. The weakness of this whole discussion, though, is that it assumes the only way to solve the traveling salesman problem is to list the tours one after the other. So you check one, check its length, go to the next one. And it's not at all clear that's true. In fact, the brilliant young mathematician, Karl Menger, in Vienna in 1930, posed that as a mathematical challenge. Can we actually do better than that? But this is a deep question. But this is 1930. This predates Alan Turing, predates any discussion of general purpose computing. So at that time, mathematics was dealt with existential questions. Either there is something or not. For the traveling salesman problem, there is an algorithm, just check them all. he's asking for better than finite algorithms. Right? It's really the start, not just of the traveling salesman problem, but of complexity theory. So once you decide that, well, n factorial is not good, it takes forever, what would be acceptable? So as the number of points n gets larger, the problem is going to be harder to solve. Well, at least because it takes more time to read it in. So what would be acceptable? Well, the gold standard here was laid down by John von Neumann, who was one of the greatest mathematicians of the last century. What von Neumann did, not for the traveling salesman problem, but for a related optimization problem, the relaxation, he found an algorithm that runs in time n to the power 3. So n points takes n cubed time. And that's much, much smaller than 20 factorial, even for just 20 points. All right, so that became the gold standard. So not necessarily n cubed, you have n squared, n fourth, n to the fifth, n to some fixed power. So a polynomial time algorithm. So we could strengthen Menger's question. Is there a polynomial time algorithm for the traveling salesman problem? Already in 1956, Merle Flood, who was a optimization pioneer, he started to think this is not possible. He's looking for impossibility results. By the mid-1960s, the complexity guru, Jack Edmonds, flat out conjectures, you'll never have a polynomial time algorithm for the TSP. That's what he calls a good algorithm, it's a polynomial time algorithm. By the early 70s, Richard Karp, riding on the crest of newly developed complexity theory, proves that the traveling salesman problem is NP complete, which means the TSP is one problem to rule them all. If you solve the traveling salesman problem, polynomial time, you can solve a whole host of other problems as well. It transfers that quality guarantee. All right, and from that reason, it's now tied up into this great open mathematical question, P versus NP. I don't want to say anything other than pointing out N doesn't mean non-polynomial, it means non-deterministic polynomial. It's a good thing to be an NP, not a bad thing. But don't want to go into details, but the takeaway is that if you find polynomial time algorithm, so if you find an N cubed algorithm for the traveling salesman problem, take the train up to New Hampshire, go to the Clay Math Institute, they'll hand you over $1 million check. Right? So just go ahead and get to it. And there's already a good starting point. So unbeknownst to the writers of the Washington Post, Menger's initial question was already settled in 1962. So Richard Bellman, Michael Held, and Richard Karp, they independently came up with an algorithm, the same algorithm, that runs in for n points, solve this TSP in n squared, 2 to the power n times. So it's not polynomial. N squared is polynomial, but 2 to the n is exponential function. So it grows fast, but it grows way slower than factorial. So at 22, you only have 2 billion operations, which a computer can do very quickly, versus 25 billion tours to check. That's good. The bad thing is that this is a relatively simple algorithm. Like I could explain it in details in 10 or 15 minutes. You completely understand the algorithm. And yet there's been no improvement in that exponential term in 59 years. We're not even inching closer to polynomial time. Oh, that's bad. So maybe I'm asking too much to actually solve the TSP. What if I ask, you can spend polynomial time, but at least get really close to an optimal score? Well, in general, there's no answer to that. The getting close is just as hard as solving the traveling salesman problem itself. But in a special case, we can give it a guarantee. The special case is called the triangle inequality, which says that it's a natural thing, says that going from A to B can't be any longer than first going to C and then to B. So the shortest way to get A to B is just go directly. You can't take a detour to save your time. But that's a very natural condition. Under that condition, we can get a 1.5 approximation, which means that you're most 50% longer than optimal tour. So how do you do that? Well, you start by just connecting the points, and it's called a spanning tree, the cheapest way. Now, tour also connects the points. So this network, this tree that connects them, is less than or equal to the length of the best tour. Now, what we do next is we pair up the points that meet an odd number of edges here. So some of these nodes, like this one, meet 3 edges, this one meets 2. We're going to pair up the odd ones in a minimum cost way. So it's called a matching, pairs of points. And Jack Edmonds knows how to do that in polynomial time. Now, his matching is less than or equal to half the length of an optimal tour, because an optimal tour consists of two matchings. You take the alternate every second edge. All right, so you add those together, you have 1.5 now. This says it's the most length of the tour, that's half the length of the tour. At this point, each node, each point meets an even number of edges. So you can apply an ancient theorem of graph theory called the Königsberg bridge theorem of Euler, which says that you can then walk amongst all those edges and use each one exactly once. That must not be a tour, but it can be shortcutted into a tour. So if you ever visit a node a second time, you just skip it over. Because of the triangle inequality, that doesn't increase the length. So it's very simple. These ingredients were put together by Nikos Christofidis in 1976. The paper wasn't even published in a journal. Simple ideas. But like Bellman held carp, it stood the test of time. No improvement for 44 years. All right, so you're all keen on mathematics. You realize that, well, why didn't I write 45 years? Well, that's because there was an improvement last year, right? These three researchers used very sophisticated methods, so 89-page proof, to get the smallest of epsilon below 1.5. And there's a really nice article about this in Quantum Magazine, if you're interested. So the hope is that now we're a little bit below 1.5, maybe we can get significantly below, like say 1.4. But I have to say that this is a breakthrough, very important theoretical result. So most certainly going to win prizes once it's completely refereed. But in practice, like your Amazon, are you really happy with having a tour that's 49% longer than you might need it to be? So the question is, forget about these fancy math guarantees. I just have this problem of routing my truck. Can you give me a better result? Well, the answer is yes. So with Dave Applegate from Google and Kjeld Helsken from Denmark, for example, we computed a tour through every town and village on Earth. And well, we don't have the optimal solution, but we're within the factor of 1.0002, so three goose eggs. That's 2,500 times better than the Christofidis guarantee. The difference is our result just holds for this problem. We're not giving you a method that's going to get this result for every problem, but you give me a problem, almost certainly I'm going to get this result, at least that good. And the techniques we use are based on a lot of work, but the main idea was already known to Curious George. You see, George is going to get really upset at that. See, what he's upset is that their tour crossed. And you don't want to do that, right? In the shortest possible tour, because of the Pythagorean theorem, you don't want to cross. You should delete those crossed edges and reconnect the paths. Pythagorean theorem would say that you save some distance. Merle Flood, who made the first serious effort to get good tours, he used that not just for geometric problems, but for any problem. You take two edges, consider deleting them and reconnecting. You get a shorter tour, he calls that a two-ops move, you go ahead and make it. And yes, repeat, so a local search algorithm. So watch how it takes this random tour and it'll quickly clean it up. So it takes pairs of edges, deletes them, and reconnects. So it starts out terrible, slowly gets better. So this method is called local search because he's sitting at a tour and he looks around his neighbors. The neighbors are those that you get from uncrossing pairs. And if one of the neighbors is better, you go to it. So it's like hill climbing. You're trying to get the highest point in New York. You would go on the top of this nice building I was just in a few minutes ago and just look around. You see the highest building, you run over and go up that. Then from there, look around so you can see the higher building. So it's a hill climbing method. And this was the starting point for a great body of research. The main work was by Shen Lin and Brian Kernighan. Brian Kernighan, you might know the name. He's the one inventor of the Unix operating system, C programming language. The same person. They engineered a marvelous algorithm that considers not two-op, but k-op for variant k, where you delete k edges and reconnect the paths. Combining that with many things over the years, genetic algorithms and simulated annealing, many techniques, all go into the state-of-the-art code by Kjeld Helsken, LKH. Helsken codes is marvelous. You give it a problem, it almost invariably gives you a really good tour. But it comes with no guarantee, at least no good guarantee, not even as good as Christofidis' guarantee. So going back to those newspapers articles, Is it really impossible to solve the problem for 22 cities? Well, Amazon, which was running that $100,000 contest, sort of reinforces the idea. They said because it's NP complete, which CARP showed, that except for the simplest of instances, it's intractable. All right, but that wasn't the thinking of Drs. Bellman, Held, and CARP. Their paper is renowned for its complexity theory, but the papers themselves are discussing exact computation. Indeed, Dave Applegate and I, we coded up the Bellman Held CARP algorithm, and it solves 22 city problems, not in 1,000 years, but in 0.005 seconds. Right? So I wrote that it was like reporting the US national debt is $4. Right? All right, and this is just the tip of the iceberg. There's a whole line of mathematics aimed at getting good solutions to concrete examples. All right, so just get it done. Complexity theory be damned. Right, so what does complexity theory tell us? It's likely that as n goes off to infinity, you're going to encounter some instances of the traveling salesman problem that no one will be ever to solve. That doesn't mean I can't solve your problem. It just means there's some bad problems. And that's the whole line of research. This really started with Hassler Whitney. And he's known for his pure math, but I really like this, the applied nature of his letter that he wrote to his aunt when he's six. I mean, I have a desk, I have a pad, especially this one. Geography is spelt geography, right? That's really mathematician, I think. Or what he did for the traveling salesman problem was he bought this abstract geometric asymptotic conjecture or question of Menger, and he brought it home for something people can really get their hands on. What he said, rather than letting n go to infinity, Whitney just posed a 48 states problem. Pick one point in each state and find the shortest tour through. So finite example. And this had a lot of influence on people. So the first paper that's ever has a traveling salesman problem named to it is by Julia Robinson. Julia Robinson is a towering figure in mathematics. She led the team that solved Hilbert's 10th problem. There's a movie, feature-length movie, about that. For the traveling salesman problem, though, rather than thinking theoretically as n goes to infinity, she wants to work on the mathematics of solving n equals 50. What can she do to help in this finite case? In her work, she did this at the it was called the RAND Corporation. This is Project RAND. Led 5 years later to the biggest breakthrough in the area. So a team at RAND, led by George Danzig, Ray Fulkerson, Summer Johnson, they actually solved Hassler Whitney's 48 states problem. So 48 points for each state plus Washington, DC. There's only 48 states at the time. The big thing I want to emphasize is they did this by hand. There weren't really accessible computers at the time. So just 5 years ago, pretty much every newspaper in the country, it was also on the morning edition of the weekend edition of NPR, saying it's impossible to find a route through 50 cities. And yet they did this in 1954 by hand. Right? And in the article that it was sort of a triumph at the time, the article appeared in Newsweek, was really spot on, saying that this was an application of linear programming. All right, so linear programming is the big elephant in the TSP world, also in the optimization world. It's certainly one of the triumphs of applied mathematics. So it was developed by Danzig in the 1940s, together with a simplex algorithm for its solution. The simplex algorithm is named one of the top 10 algorithms of the century for its application. You pretty much can't pick up any product where linear programming is not involved in some aspect of its design, manufacture, or delivery. All right, so linear programming model itself, some of you may know about this, but it's worth spending a couple minutes on it. It's a simple model. And that's a plus, right? It's simple means that it's easy to apply and also easy to understand. For example, this is from the Algebra 1 class of a high school in San Diego. The two students, Zoe and Stefan, made a little linear programming problem on a cake. So linear programming is about making optimal decisions. Here, the variables making a decision is how many quarts of the different types of ice cream they're going to make. So the X is the number of quarts of buttercream and Y is the number of quarts of chocolate swirl. And they want to make maximize their profit. They earn $3 on one and $2 the other, but they can't just say, well, that X equals a million, because they don't have enough ingredients. They don't have enough sugar or cream, and those consume sugar and cream. So linear programming, what it does is maximizes a linear function subject to linear equality and equations. Linear inequalities and so constraints. It's a constrained optimization problem. The ones that are taking place in business today, they have tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of variables. And yet they can be solved routinely by simplex algorithm and other methods. So this was the mid 40s. 1949, Robinson decides to apply this type of technology to the traveling salesman problem. So what is her decisions? Well, she's not looking at what order you visit things in. She's considering what segments do you use. So if you travel directly from A to D, then variable XAD would be one. Otherwise, XAD would be zero. That's her variables. So her objective function is to minimize the total length. So the distance times whether you use it or not. Then she would like to say, well, subject to the variables giving you a tour. Well, you can't do that in linear programming. You have to have these simple constraints. So she makes some simple constraints that are satisfied by all tours. The first one is just that the variables are greater than or equal to zero. Well, sure, they're zero or one. The second one is for each point, she says that we sum over all the variables that meet that point. And that sum should be exactly two. Well, yeah, again, sure, because the tour comes into the point and leaves it. So you use two edges. So you sum over those variables should be exactly two. So if I have a four-point problem, it looks like that. You have six variables, and you have four constraints, one for each point. And these are very easy to solve for linear programming methods. So Danzig's team, they started with Julia Robinson's relaxation. And what I've displayed here is the optimal solution to that assignment problem. So it has these triangles. See, they're using two edges. But it also has many of these points that where the tour is going back and forth. That means that variable took on the value two. So you look at that picture, they say, well, they must have been a little bit disappointed. It's not going to help them to find a good tour. But there's something very valuable. It's this number down here, 532. So every tour was a candidate solution for this linear programming problem. So it's a potential solution. This is the best solution. That means no tour can have length better than 532, which is valuable. Because Danzig's team had already computed a tour of length 699. They have strange units, about 17 miles is one of their units. How they found the tourists, they had a piece of wood, put down the map, the locations of the cities, took a string, tied it to one point, and then used that string to trace out tours. Doing that, they found the tour through 699. So together with that 532, they know the optimal tour is between 532 and 699. You just have to close the gap. So looking at the linear programming problem, they decide, well, what's the easiest thing to do? We want to add more constraints. The constraints have to be satisfied by all tours. And well, look, a tour makes that value one. So they added the constraints saying each variable is one. This is actually a significantly harder LP to solve. That's why Julian Robinson didn't consider it. But 5 years later, they had more sophisticated tools to work with. So they add those constraints in and bang, it goes up to 641. Now they know they're between 641 and 699, right? And something creeps in though here, something nasty. Linear programming variables don't necessarily take on values zero and one. They could be fractions. And this solution has some at value half, the red ones. And well, what we like to do is say, all right, next constraint, make everybody integer. Well, you can't do that. That's not in a linear programming problem. So what they have to do is that indirectly, you can add further constraints that try to force the linear programming solution away from that fractional solution. And here there's an obvious example. You have this island up here around Maine. Any salesman tour has to use at least two segments going into that island. So you add that to the constraint saying that sum over all those edges, those segments, has to be at least two. So it's called a subtour elimination constraint, subtour constraint. And it increases to 676. So now they knew 676 to 699, the tour somewhere in there, the optimal value. And see, adding that one constraint, you really do have two leaving here now, two red ones, one black one, they sum to two. And another island popped up. So now you know what their game's going to be. keep in mind, they're doing all this by hand. This is nothing to do on computer now, but they're doing all this by hand. Big problem. But he said, watch the way it rips through the problem. So whenever you have an answer that's not a tour, you stare at it, add some constraint that's violated by that given solution, but satisfied by all tours. So it's called the cutting plane method, because it cuts off these fractional or these non-tour solutions. And it's fantastic that they solved it. Actually, it turned out to be 699. So they had guessed right in the beginning. They just didn't know it. Right. Their method is very powerful. They did it by hand, write a computer program. Now it's possible to solve 100 point examples in just some seconds. So not these thousands of years. Of course, the avid readers of the Washington Post are just not going to believe that this is true. Why should they? The Washington Post says it's impossible. But there's some magic in linear programming. Linear programming will actually be able to convince, with a little bit of thinking, will be able to convince the most skeptical person that it is in fact true. What linear programming does is it allows me to draw this pretty picture. This was an idea of Michael Younger and Bill Pulleyman. So this picture actually gives a geometric proof that a tour is optimal. So let me zoom in. Around each point, I have these blue disks. Now notice that a salesman has to get that point, has to cross the disk twice. So you can add twice the radii of the disk, they don't overlap. So twice the radii of the disk to the to get a lower bound. A salesman has to take at least that much length. So they're called control zones around each point. There's also the notion of a moat, like this yellow band. It encircles a set of points. So the salesman has to swim that moat at least twice, go in and out. Those correspond to the subtour constraints, actually. So these are moats. So I can add twice the width of the moat to my lower bound. And if you get out a ruler, you can measure everything. You find that the length of the tour exactly matches the lower bound. But you don't have to do all that work. Just looking at the picture will convince you. Notice that every edge is completely covered by these regions. And every region is crossed exactly twice by the tour. Those two facts together mean that they have the same length. All right, I want to take a break now to do the activity, to drive this point home of trying to get this lower bound. So if you happen to have a phone or a tablet, you could go to the link salesman.momath.org. So if this fancy setup works, I should have it here. All right, so it'll take you to this page. So salesman.momath.org. Okay. When you get there, just click the let's go, and it'll generate a 5-point problem. So there'll be two phases to this exercise. The first one is to find a tour, which is easy. So just take your phone and click on the points in the order you like to visit them. That's very easy to get the shortest possible tour this way. Okay, so you get a tour of value 16891. It gives a tour length of the problem. Very easy. Finding a tour on 5 points is something humans can do very easily. Okay, but now we want to compute the bound. So if you go up to the top, there's that bound. Go and click on build a bound. So the nodes will turn red. All right, now select any node just with your finger, or if you're at home with your mouse. You click any point. The point will turn green, and then there'll be a slider at the top. If you make that slider, it'll increase the control zone. And as you do that, you look at the bottom of the page for something important that is giving you the lower bound. So in this case, 2434.5. And it's giving you a factor telling you how far away are you from the best tour. Right? So this is now, our lower bound is 6 times. Well, we want it to be 1, at least better than Christofides, at least better than 1.5. So what you do is you go ahead and if you finish with that node, you click it and it turn back red, then go to another node and click it. It'll turn green. Then if I pick two nodes like this, I can actually grow a moat. Right, and then if I, you can always click clear to turn all the ones back to red, and you can grow the zones. Let me turn that one off. All right, and now let's maybe grow another moat around those points. All right, now I have a lower bound that's 1.1. So it's better than Christofides. So the challenge is, can anyone find a factor down here, so packing, that's better than 1.1? Hopefully down 1.0. If anyone gets 1.0, then I'll give them a free copy of my book. Otherwise, I'm going to give it to the youngest person here.
And for those online, feel
those
free
online,
to post
I can't
the
give
results.
You the book, but you'll get the glory.
Feel free to post the results in the chat.
Yeah. You'll get the glory of having done it.
And anyone in the studio audience here can raise their hand if they think they've got a good number.
So you just want to get better than, right now, just to beat the one I wrote, you want to get 1.1. It's possible to make things smaller. Like once I have that set up, if I wanted to make that smaller, I could. Right, I could choose ones and a. And of course it's going to get the same value if I just draw a moat around those three. It's a prettier picture, but it still just gives me 1.1. So to get things better, what you like to do is find two things that you are three points that if you make the middle one smaller, you make the other two larger.
And if anyone has any problems with the program, feel free to raise your voice or raise your hand.
The book's really good, by the way. You really want to get all these beautiful color pictures in it. The text I wrote, so it might not be that good, but the pictures are really good. Yeah, what do you got?
There's no factor on our phone. Like it doesn't show the factor. Like,
oh, it's a small phone. Yeah, way back. Did you make a tour first?
Yeah, Alex. You have to make the tour first. Yeah, if you first make the tour, and then start building. So when you go to tour, build a tour. You see the. I don't know how to show you this.
No, I think you better start over again and make the tour first. Yeah.
Yeah, start over and then go tour, build a tour, and then bound and build a bound.
Oh, sure. It shows the bound, but it doesn't show the factor. Yeah. See?
Did you do the tour? Did you start with?
You can try.
Yes, that's good. Factor.
So a couple of questions here to everyone. Are we supposed to look at the DIY bound or the factor?
Factor is easier to measure.
And another note here, if you turn the phone horizontally,
you got the record so far?
If you turn the phone horizontally, the factor should show up.
1.09. Does anyone have better than a 1.09? That's not so good. 1.09 is the champion so far. 1.1 was here, yeah.
Again, if anyone missed it, if you turn the phone horizontally, the factor should show up.
Okay, that was fun. You can keep doing it. I'll reward the 1.09 for the successful. Congratulations. So the reason I chose this is that the tour is very easy, but the bound seems to be difficult. And that's where I said the magic of linear programming comes in. Linear programming is going to get that bound in a snap, not just for 5 points, 22 points, even 50 points. All right, so how linear programming does that? So it's this magical thing. Again, John von Neumann had his hand in lots of the mathematics of the last century. So linear programming possesses a duality theorem. So linear programming problems come in pairs. So if you're minimizing, that's called the primal LP, and the maximum is the dual LP. And the pairs of LPs are such that for the minimization, you're trying to push down as far as you can. Maximization, you're trying to push up. The pair of problems is such that any solution to the dual problem gives us a bound on how good you can do in the primal. So you can never go past one another. You get close, but you can't go past. But Neumann's theorem is, in fact, the two are equal. So if I give half of the room, assign them to the primal problem, the other half of the room to go in a different room to the dual problem, they both do their work correctly, you'll get the same value, the yin and yang. And we should thank the computational gods that that's true, because that allows for the solution of large linear programming problems. Because the two problems certify one another. You know you're optimal because you can't go below it. Right? And that's what's giving us this bound. So let's look at it for the traveling salesman problem. This is the assignment problem. To get the dual problem, you take its transpose, you turn it on its side. So in the primal problem, we had these twos on the right-hand side. Now we have twos in the objective. Here we have distances on the right-hand side. The primal had distances in the objective. Here we had a constraint for each point. Here we have a variable for each point. And the variables are giving us the radius of each disk. And these constraints saying that RA plus RB is less than equal to the distance means they don't overlap. So the dual variables are giving us those control zones. We add in a subtour constraint that adds in a single variable to the dual. And again, it says these constraints say that we have enough room to draw it. And in a dual, the objective function is twice the sum of the radii plus twice the width of the disk, which is exactly what we wanted. So bingo, right? Von Neumann tells us that solution here is going to be equal to a solution there. Indeed, wasn't just that one case. There are many cases. It's very easy to find 100-point examples with proofs. Some of them are a little bit exotic, that you wouldn't be able to do this easily by hand, but the computer solved all these just in a few seconds. Okay, so why don't I just take these pictures up to the Clay Math Center and get my $1 million? Well, I mentioned that there is this catch with linear programming, that the variables might not take integer values. So it might not be a tour. It's kind of hard to find a 10-point example. I had to do about 10,000 random examples, but I didn't look at them one at a time. I wrote a computer code to do it. But here's an example on 10 points where the LP solution has about half. Von Neumann's not lying. The length of this LP solution is equal to the lower bound, just not a tour. But that's okay. You just have to go beyond those subtour inequalities. You have to get more complicated ones. So I skipped over this, but actually Danzig, Folks, and Johnson, after doing 7 subtours, you need 2 more complicated constraints. The only property you have to have is the constraint is satisfied by all tours. If the constraint is satisfied by all tours, you can add it. They do 9 constraints, solve the problem. They did this sort of just by rolling up their sleeves and getting the job done. But there's theoretical justification. There's a theorem of Minkowski from, a long time ago, the turn of the previous century, which you can interpret it as meaning that for the traveling salesman or other problems, there's a perfect LP formulation, I mean, a linear programming formulation where the answer is going to be a tor. All right, so there's always money in the cutting play method. You can never get stuck if you work hard enough. And that's what Danzig, Folks, and Johnson did. They don't know, I have to say, we don't know what that perfect LP formulation is, even for a 10-point problem. We just don't know it. Didn't stop them. They bashed on regardless. They said, well, I'm going to get it for this particular example. And they did. And this is the last line in our paper. Perhaps some of these ideas might be useful. Yeah, that's really modest. This is the most important paper ever written in discrete optimization. Once people understood that, their methods were used for a wide swath of applications. And for the TSP itself, I mean, took a lot of years for people to understand their work. So this is the largest size of the largest TSP instance from some interesting test library. So there's not points on a circle. Their record stood for nearly 20 years, 49 points by hand. Computers were widely available. Finally, in 1971, it was defeated. But you see this plot of the biggest problems, it's on a log scale. So the fact that there's a nice linear fit means we're increasing exponentially fast. So through the 80s, the work was dominated by Grocho and Padberg. Starting in 1992, all the records were solved by our Concord code. So with Applegate, Bixby, and Quattel, more recently also with Espinosa, Gukuyaya, and Helskin. All these problems are points in two-dimensional problems, except for this biggest one. It's actually a 3D problem that gives pretty pictures, if I can get to the web page here. All right, so what you're seeing is the shortest possible tour through 109,000 stars, 3D positions of 109,000 stars. If I zoom out, you'll see their shape. So it's a ball-like structure. I have to say this 109,000, the full database actually had more, and we actually solved that. It just, you see, I don't really count that as a TSP record because if I go to it, this 100 and instead of 109 has 119. You'll see why I wouldn't really count this. So this problem, the full database, and I didn't know it until we actually solved the problem. And then I drew the picture that it has 10,000 points where they didn't really know how far it was from Earth. So they put them all on a sphere. There's 10,000 points on a sphere. Then if I zoom in, you eventually get down to that core set that we solved. So solving this big problem actually solved on 10,000 points on the sphere and figured out the best two ways to get into that inner core. So it's kind of cheating. So I don't consider that a solution, but actually this was difficult to solve just for data reasons, handling that weird point set. Okay, so that's the largest instance that's been solved exactly. I have to say those big ones take years. That one took about 20 years to solve. Well, I worked on this problem for a long time, but it wasn't that I just sat there for 20 years and kept hoping. We ran it in parallel. But I could say that there's a trickle-down effect. So the world record problem before 1992 was a 2,000-point problem. It's solved on this old iPhone 8 in 18 seconds. But nonetheless, all the newspapers across the country say we can't solve a 50-point problem. That's a little bit disappointing, but there's something to say about this. So what these articles and what was on NPR was a nice tour, not an optimal tour, but a pretty good tour through 50 points, landmarks in the US. And it wasn't geometric distances. These were rogue distances. It still had a property that from A to B is the same as B to A, but there were rogue distances. And of all these record solutions, only two small ones have that property. So there weren't Google Maps in the old days. Map atlases used to come with these matrices of distances. Those two are like that. All the rest of them are just straight line Euclideans. So it may be that all this work on the TSP was overfitting to geometric problems. So we wanted to study that. So together with Daniel Espinosa, who now works for Google, Marcos Cuculier from Chile, and Kjeld Helskens from Denmark, we solved not over 50 cities, but nearly 50,000 US historical points. And this was Google's, asking Google's walking distance, because we wanted A to B the same as B to A. who had walking distances. And a result is that you can't even make a meter shorter. This is the shortest possible tour. And I really like its complexity. I mean, it's not straight line. If you look at the how it goes in a mall area, it goes right up this little path, the winding path going up to the Washington Monument and back down. And to show that it wasn't just luck, this was in 2016. 2 years later, we solved another problem in the UK with nearly 50,000 points. And just a couple months ago, we solved the Dutch problem with nearly 58,000 points. The first two were walking, the Dutch problem was biking. The tour, the distances were provided to us by a firm, CQM, gives this big matrix of all the biking distances. These were big and difficult examples. Each one of these is taking about 150, 200 years to solve. These are big computations. So I didn't just go from 50 points up to right up to 50,000 as a warm-up. We solved a problem that had some 24,000 pubs in the UK. All right, and people like the idea of pub crawl. So it somehow got to the UK press, and there's many articles about it. All right, but once they started appearing, I started getting this flood of messages and emails from Mattyboy19, the Meat Beep, all saying that my tour is crap. It's the shortest possible tour, but what is crap is that I'm missing their pub, their favorite pub. Right? The articles were saying all, and it wasn't all. The database had many more, but I removed things that didn't sound like a pub to me. So if it had hotel in the name, I just kicked it out. Unfortunately, this kicked out most of the pubs in Scotland, and most of these people are Scottish. They're letting me know. All right, so but applied mathematician, they want more pubs. That's how we end up going for that second 50,000 point problem. Went back to the database and I did every pub. All right, so there's many more points in Scotland, even going up to the Northern Isles where you have to take ferry boats to get to your favorite pubs. Okay, but that's not the end of the line for the TSP. So the reason we did this is we wanted to show that these methods aren't just for geometric problems. Now we're interested in knowing whether the methods can really be applied to 3D problems. So I already showed you that one example. Nice thing about astronomy, they have really big data sets. So the European Space Agency has a Gaia mission. They put out enough information to get approximate 3D positions for some 2 million stars. Kjeld Helsken and I worked hard for over a year on this problem. We couldn't quite solve it, but we're really close. Right, the tour has some 28 million parsecs. The LP is also 28 million, right? It only differs way down here. So we're only off by 220 parsecs. So we have a tour and a guarantee that's at least that long. So if I take that ratio, like you were trying to get that factor, this factor is 0.00050, five goose eggs, 0.74. Right, so I checked that in the Olympic swimming pools, the difference in the length between lanes in the Olympic swimming pool is worse than this. This is more accurate than the Olympic swimming pool. If you think about driving, it's like going from here to San Francisco, maybe not on the shortest path, but you're off by most, say, the width of this room. Right, so this is very close to this. So there's no application, but it did fulfill a long-time goal of mine. We got written up on the sci-fi network. So I like science fiction, so that was a big thing. In fact, Kjeld Helsken and I think that our tour is actually much better than the bound indicates. Right? So we know the optimal solutions between the tour and the LP. We think it's closer to the tour. So in order to try to find that out, we offered a reward of $50 for each parsec you can make the tour shorter. Right? So there's 28 million parsecs. That's fit. Well, I don't have $100 million or so to give you, but so we capped it at 10,000 total, but in fact, we know bound. We know there's the most 220, but we have put 10,000 in the bank, so it's ready for you. So far, no one's collected this. This was posted in the fall. The reason we want to know it is because when working this linear programming, we want to know what's the real answer. So if you have any ideas, the data set is out there, just chip away at it. Going even larger, The European Space Agency now has 3D data on 1.3 billion stars. Here, the big issue is actually computing the LP bound. So we only have a really weak approximation of the LP bound. Dave Applegate, this is with Dave Applegate with Google. Dave's team is working on big parallel codes to approximately solve linear programming problems, which is enough, right? We're not going to solve such a big linear programming problem exactly. What you need is just some solution to the dual to get the bound. This is magic of linear programming. So right now we have an approximation that's two goose eggs. That's much better than 1.5, and we expect to get at least one more goose egg once the full LP solver gets done. So this is, again, no application. The motivation here is driving the development of techniques to handle really big LPs. So I don't know exactly why Google wants this, but they do. And the LP is driving this work. All right, so Google's working on the TSP, and you should too. All right, so why? Well, there's obviously no real application of going through 2 million stars. And even if there were, we have a really accurate solution. Our solution is way more accurate than the actual positions. All right, the reason for doing this from the optimization community's point of view is that the TSP has been wildly successful as an engine of discovery. So many of the household names always apply techniques like branch and bound, simulated and annealing. They first appeared in TSP research papers. Right? So this is a way of discovering new technology. That's for the community. On a more personal level, so why am I trying to convince you to work on the TSP? Well, I think it's somewhat similar to the Ben Kingsley character in the Searching for Bobby Fischer chess movie set in New York. He says why he's doing this, why is he teaching this student, is because he wants to get back the attacking spirit that Bobby Fischer took away with him when he left chess. And that's what I want. I want the attacking spirit of searching for Julia Robinson. So Julia Robinson wrote the first paper on the TSP, but the history, you'll see, makes that even more remarkable. She had her PhD in the purest of mathematics. She worked in logic, undecidable problems, 1948. Then she goes from Berkeley down to Santa Monica, takes up a postdoctoral fellowship with what's been called the most remarkable group of mathematicians ever work on optimization. So here she is, trained in pure math. She's going among these top applied mathematicians in the world. All right, when she gets there, what does she do? She picks the hardest problem. She picks the traveling salesman problem. That's the one she's going to study. All right, that's really aggressive. But if you look at their notes she wrote when she was preparing for the application to the RAND Corporation, she writes that she likes working best on problems that are easy to state or for which you don't really know how to solve them. All right, and that fits the traveling salesman problem exactly. And it still does. Still much more work to be done. All right, so that's my spiel, but why should you solve it? Well, maybe you want to meet your prime minister or president or chancellor. These are five prominent TSP researchers, all with their heads of state. For example, here's Marta Grocho, whose name I mentioned a couple of times, with Angela Merkel. You want to meet the president, chancellor? I mean, this is Mahala Lobes, who I didn't mention, but he worked in the statistics applications of the TSP with Nehru. You want to meet your head of state, work on the TSP. If you want to have a startup company, well, it's also a good starting point to work on the TSP. This is Bob Bixby. I mentioned that those records were solved with Amplgate, Bixby, Clotel. That's Bixby. He parlayed his knowledge of the TSP to making codes, the most successful codes, to find integer solutions to linear programming problems. This is also hard, just as hard as the traveling salesman problem. But he gets very good solutions. From that, he's had a couple of companies that got him bags of money. So right now he's floating on his luxury yacht somewhere out in the Caribbean. All right, so you want to do a startup company? Well, TSP is not a bad place to start. If you're just interested in theoretical math, Ola Swenson won a $100,000 help prize for his result on approximations to traveling salesman problems. You like programming contests, I mentioned a couple of times the Amazon contest. The winners were announced just this past Friday. In fact, we won. So we received $100,000 together. Thank you. Thank you very much. Together with Stefan Hell from Bonn and Kelda Helskin, my longtime collaborator. So if you want to do programming contests, work on the TSP. All right, but maybe the most important reason goes back to a story with Feynman, the great physicist. Feynman was at Stanford, and a young Nicholas Christofides, who hadn't yet had his big result, but he was interested in the TSP. He's wandering the halls of Stanford, And this Feynman comes up to him, and Christofides knew who he was. Feynman didn't know who Christofides was, but said, well, what are you working on? So Christofides explains the traveling salesman problem. Feynman goes home, thinks about it, comes back the next day, finds Christofides and said, yeah, you're right, this is a hard problem. Have fun with it. And indeed, the traveling salesman problem, it's capturing all this complexity and optimization, but you get your hands on it, right? It's something you really think about. And yet you might make discoveries that have wide impact. All right, so that's the idea, to have fun. So Richard Karp, the great computer scientist, he says, despite all of his great accomplishments, the most thrill he had was the night his computer TSP results were coming out of the computer. Or the optimizer Harold Kuhn from Princeton. He wrote that he's worked for 48 years on the TSP. So there must be something there. Or Christoph Papenitru said the traveling salesman problem is not a problem, it's an addiction. And indeed, well, I've myself been working on it now for about 30 years. It's certainly addictive, but it's not one that I would like to cure. I mean, just the opposite. I would get little TSP challenges and wrap them up in candies and throw them out, right? Because the traveling salesman problem, we have, as I said, a well-defined optimization problem that can allow you to make discoveries that can push forward optimization methods. So optimization is one way to help in utilizing our resources as best possible. Right? And with through a TSP, you might be able to do that. So you're welcome to join the campaign. Thank you, everybody.
All right, so we have time for questions. And if anybody online on the Zoom call has a question, feel free to type it in chat and I will ask the question. And anyone in the audience can raise their hand and I will bring them the microphone.
So first of all, congratulations on the 100,000 winning the competition. If your program was already out there and was being given to all these other companies, why didn't they just enter and run the competition?
Oh yeah, that's a good point. So as I said, I mentioned in the beginning, they wanted not just short routes, they wanted safe routes. So this contest was really designed for machine learning or artificial intelligence. So what they did is they gave us, all the contestants got 6,000 examples of routes they wanted to do, together with what the drivers actually drove on those routes. Then they wanted you to predict sort of the idea is that the drivers might know safe place to park or a shorter little route. You're supposed to try to find tours that predict what the drivers would do. So they should be short, but also incorporating some of the driver's decisions. And so the contest was that you design your code based on those 6,000 examples, and then they tested it on 3,000 others. And they had a measure of how close you get. And the team that got closest in their measure won the contest.
All right, from online, how is the 3D problem different from planar TSP, if at all?
How is the what problem?
The 3D problem.
Well, for us, one of the big differences is that in two dimensions, if you look at the linear programming solution, the linear programming solution tends not to cross. That's called a planar graph. Inside the graph there, planar graphs are something special, and we can use that planar graph structure to find inequalities. 3D, they're wildly non-planar because they just cross all over the place because of the three-dimensionality.
And Curious George didn't help with that one.
No, Curious George didn't help with that.
I wanted to ask you about the first 3D problem you showed, the 10,000 points on the sphere.
Yes.
From the back row, it looked like all the connections were on the sphere. Where if it were a 3D problem, it seemed like they would go through the sphere. But I guess if the points are close enough, I wouldn't be able to tell the difference.
So you mean the star problem or the Earth?
Yeah, the star problem.
Yeah, the Earth problem. Yeah, they aren't really going on the sphere. They are just connecting.
They're just close to each other. So
yeah, it is going like straight. It's not following the curve.
So they're all very close.
As I said, when we first solved it, I didn't know the point set had that. I just noticed that, wow, this is doing weird stuff. The code couldn't really decide what are those two edges that go out to the outside sphere. So all the edges looked alike. And I hadn't seen that before. It was only that we spent all this time solving that I realized that it had this odd structure. Do you have the microphone?
Let me just take this one here, okay. And I'll get to you in a second. If there is a large number of points, why can't you use a continuous method like minimizing surface area?
Well, all right, so it is true that if your points, say in two dimensions, happen to lie on the convex hull, they all lie on the surface, then in two dimensions, you just take that convex hull toward it and short as possible. The trouble with these three-dimensional cases, it's kind of wild, the interior. The surface is almost like a solid that you would have.
Let me get this other one online before I go to the one in the audience. Oh, we got a couple here, good. Delivery companies want to minimize left-hand turns. How does this constraint enter into TSP?
Yeah, that's a good question. We actually thought about that for this contest, whether we should try to incorporate that. So there's this notion. So what we had though was the amount of time it takes to go from, so Amazon, the data set wasn't distance, it was the amount of seconds it takes to get from point to point. So we just decided, well, this is probably incorporating the left-hand turn into it.
I just had a quick question. Have you seen any application of your algorithm that was used that isn't for distance optimization that just kind of sticks out to you? That was like an application for Concord that was used that was, you know, interesting to you or unique.
What applications are interesting?
Yeah, did you have like?
Well, some of them I actually quite like. We got into astronomy because so astronomers they were using these big ground-based telescopes to do like say 100 observations in a night. And the telescope has to rotate in strange ways using their motors. So they know how long it took to go from point to point. So they incorporated that as a TSP. What order? I quite like that.
We may have had something like this in the last session. Does Narendra Karmarkar's interior point method help with this problem, or is it not applicable?
Well, it's Karmarkar's algorithm solves single linear programming problems. And it's now called the Barry point methods, but they grew out of Karmarkar, and they're quite good for solving single LPs. Like for that really big problem, we just want to solve a single LP. But in general, when we're solving the cutting plane method, we solve an LP, we add a constraint and resolve it. And Danzig's algorithm is really good for doing that. It can restart it, whereas Karmarkar starts over from scratch. It doesn't really work well for it in the cutting plane method.
All right, this, I don't know if this would be a short answer, a long answer. Is there a predominant opinion among mathematicians about P equals NP being true or false?
Well, I don't know. I mean, so I guess if you ask somebody on the street, well, actually my friend Basha Kwato says a psychological problem with me. I think a person on the street is somebody who I met at a conference. I think most people would say that probably it's not equal, but there's like Donald Knuth tries to argue that, well, maybe there's a chance of being equal because there's many ways that could possibly be equal. And so, you know, we're not considering every possible algorithm. So I don't know.
You're always looking at me like I've been asking the question. So I've got a question for you.
Yes.
What about
traveling? Thanks for the question.
The opposite of the traveling salesman problem to create the longest path. Is that something that?
Yeah, people actually do that. It's actually easier to do the maximum TSP, but I don't think I kind of like it. The solutions just go up, back and forth, but yeah, people have thought about that.
All right, well, there you go. If there are no other questions.
There is.
We got one back here.
Hello, can you hear me? Yeah, I have a question about what will that thing affect the algorithm if the objects are moving and maybe we know where their direction, like for example, the stars or the galaxies. If we are right.
Yeah. I mean, that'd be hard. People thought about that. If you knew the direction of motion, yeah, you could do that. But I haven't.
I was thinking also about like delivery trucks, but the pickup trucks. So if they get like orders live, they would have to.
So the Navy wrote to me about something like that. They were having an aircraft where they told me they weren't going to shoot the boats because I would be unhappy about that. They said they just wanted to ping all their enemy boats that were moving slowly compared to the speed of the aircraft, but they wanted to continuously ping those boats so they know where they're at. So the aircraft is going and the boats are moving, but moving relatively slow, but still they're moving. So there were applications on that type.
All right, well, on that dynamic question, we'll end the evening. Thank you very much, everybody. And we're going to, I think everybody online is free to unmute, and you can give a big thank you, as well as everybody in the audience, to our presenter tonight.